Hello children, I hope you are feeling fine. I welcome you all to our special English hour. Here we do a lot of activities and learn at the same time. Are you ready? Let's get started. Children, do your parents or other family members send you out to buy anything? I'm sure they must be. You must be going out to buy basic commodities like fruits, vegetables, bread, milk, and other things. How do you buy these things? Obviously, we go to the shop and we give money to the shopkeeper, and in exchange of money, the shopkeeper gives us commodities, right? But can you imagine what was world like when there was no money? Yes, there existed a time when there was no money. Then how did people buy stuff? People exchanged stuff. There was no process of buying. For example, if I wanted food grains and if my friend has food grains, I will give something in exchange of food grains. For example, if I want food grains and my friend wants cotton, so I will give her cotton in exchange of food grains. Do you know what this system is called? This system is called barter system, where we exchange materials in exchange of other materials. Do you think this system was good? Sometimes it was very good, but sometimes it wasn't, because we never got fair price for what we gave, right? Which is when money came into picture, where you pay the worth of the commodity. This is how trade also developed, where you sell something from one country to another country. For example, we see so many products in India that come from foreign countries, right? But if you go to foreign countries, you will also find many Indian products being sold in those countries. This is how world trade is carried out. Children, now let's read a story from our textbook. Please open page number 70 of your textbook. The name of the story is The Merchant of Venice. I will be reading this story and I request you to point at the words as I read them. And if you don't have a textbook, listen to me carefully. Antonio was a merchant who lived in Venice, a prosperous city in Italy. In those days, that is about 500 years ago, sea voyages were dangerous, and yet some adventurous merchants travelled across the seas. Some others spent a lot of money in sending ships to far away countries. These ships brought back spices and other treasures from India and other countries. The merchants sold these things in Europe. They made a lot of profit in this business. Antonio was a merchant from Venice. Venice is a city in Italy. Around 500 years ago, people used to go to different countries for trades. Sometimes merchants used to go by themselves, while sometimes the countries used to send them. By country, I mean the rulers of that country. For example, if I am a merchant from Spain, the king of Spain would send me to other countries. And what did we do there? The merchants used to come to countries like India and purchase spices and other commodities in very cheap rates. After purchasing these commodities, they would come back to Europe and sell these commodities at very high prices. And that is how they earned their profits. At the time when the story begins, Antonio was waiting for his ships to return with merchandise. He had put almost all his money in the ships. Antonio was a kind man. He had many friends, but his best friend was Bassanio. Bassanio was a young and handsome nobleman, but unfortunately, he had no money. This story is set around the time when Antonio had sent his ships to other countries. Now he was waiting for the merchandise to come back, which means that he was expecting some materials from the countries where the ship was sent. But his ship had not yet returned, and Antonio had put all his money on these ships. Now Antonio was a very good man. He had many friends, but his best friend was Bassanio, and he was a nobleman. What do we mean by nobleman? Nobleman is someone who is born in a very rich family. Even though Bassanio was a nobleman, he himself did not have any money. Bassanio wanted to marry Portia. Portia was beautiful and intelligent. She was the only daughter of a very wealthy man. Her father had died, leaving her a large estate. In his will, Portia's father had written how Portia's husband should be selected. He had set a test for her suitors. They had to choose between three caskets: one of gold, one of silver, and one of lead. Here we saw that Bassanio liked Portia. Portia was the daughter of a very rich trader, but her father was no more. Although he wanted Portia to get married to a really good man, and for that he had created a test for Portia's suitors. He had made 3 caskets and the suitor had to choose one of these caskets. The caskets were made out of silver, gold and lead. Each casket had something written on it. On the gold casket, it was written, "Whoever chooses me shall gain what many men desire." On the silver casket, "Whoever chooses me shall get as much as he deserves." On the casket of lead, "Whoever chooses me must give and hazard all he has." Each of these caskets had something written on them. The golden casket said that you will get everything that you desire. The silver casket said that you will get everything that you deserve. And the lead casket said that you have to give away everything. One of Portia's suitors was the Prince of Morocco. He chose the gold casket. But when he opened the casket, the message said that it was not the right casket. All that glitters is not gold. One of the suitors of Portia was the Prince of Morocco. When he came in, he chose the golden casket and it said that this is not the right choice. And the words were, "All that glitters is not gold." Do you know what this phrase means? This phrase means that we should not go on appearances. If something looks beautiful, doesn't mean that it is. It could be deceived, right? Which is why they say that all that glitters is not gold. Another suitor, the Prince of Aragon, chose the silver casket. But that too was not the right casket. Bassanio wanted to try his luck with the caskets. To do that, he had to travel to Belmont where Portia lived on her estate. He needed money for that. When Antonio came to know this, he wanted to help. He told Bassanio to borrow money in Antonio's name. They went to Shylock, the Jewish moneylender, and asked him for the money. There was another suitor who was the Prince of Aragon. He chose the silver casket, but it was not the right casket. Meanwhile, Bassanio also wanted to be one of the suitors. But for that, he would have to travel to Belmont. And he did not have enough money to travel to Belmont. So, he went to his friend Antonio. Antonio also did not have enough money. But he suggested his friends that he lends money on his name. So, they go to Shylock, who was a Jewish moneylender. Shylock had a lot of money, but he was not at all generous. Money was all that he cared for. he did not like Antonio because Antonio sometimes lent people money without charging any interest for it. Shylock had a lot of money, but he was not generous. He would not lend money just like that to anybody. And he hated Antonio because sometimes Antonio would not charge interest from the people who he used to give money. So Shylock decided to take advantage of this situation. He gave them the money on a strange condition. If Antonio failed to return the money within 3 months, Shylock would cut off a pound of Antonio's flesh. Antonio agreed to this and borrowed the money for Bassanio. Since Shylock did not like Antonio, he wanted to take revenge. So he gave them money, but he laid a very strange condition. The condition was that if Antonio is not able to pay Shylock back within 3 months, Antonio will have to give away a pound of his flesh. And Antonio agreed to do this. Bassanio went to Belmont. When he saw the caskets, he chose the lead one. That was the right casket, and Bassanio won Portia's hand by choosing it. Portia too was glad to marry Bassanio. In the meanwhile, Shylock heard that Antonio had lost his ships. He was very happy that Antonio would not be able to pay the money. He took Antonio to court and demanded that he fulfill the strange and cruel condition. The Duke liked Antonio and was sorry for him. But what could he do? Antonio had written a bond to Shylock, and according to the law, Shylock was right. Meanwhile, Bassanio had lost all his ships. Now, there was only one person who was happy to know this, and that was Shylock. He dragged Antonio to the court because now he wanted his strange wish to be fulfilled. The Duke liked Antonio, but he could not do anything about it because what was discussed between Antonio and Shylock was in a bond, and that needed to be followed. When Bassanio and Portia heard all this, they rushed back to Venice. Portia told Bassanio to pay Shylock twice the amount to save Antonio. But Shylock was adamant. He demanded only a pound of Antonio's flesh. Everyone in the court, including the Duke, felt that Shylock's demand was inhuman. The Duke asked Shylock to show mercy towards Antonio, but Shylock was not ready to do so. He felt that Antonio and others had treated him badly before. and he wanted revenge. When Portia and Bassanio heard about this, they rushed back to Venice. They wanted to help their friend. Portia even told Bassanio to pay Shylock twice the amount. But Shylock would not listen. He wanted revenge and he wanted it now. The Duke and other members of the court tried to explain to Shylock that what he wanted was very, very cruel. But Shylock was adamant and he was not going to listen to anyone. Just then, a young lawyer entered the court. He said that he would fight Antonio's case. He asked Antonio whether he had agreed to Shylock's condition. Antonio said that he had agreed. Then the young lawyer requested Shylock to show mercy, though the law was on Shylock's side. The lawyer pleaded that mercy is a quality of God Himself. When a person shows mercy to someone else, they are both blessed. Mercy was more valuable than a king's crown. But all this had no effect on Shylock. When all of this was happening, a young lawyer entered the court. He wanted to help Antonio. So he asked Antonio if he had agreed about this bond, and Antonio confessed to doing that. The new lawyer pleaded to Shylock. He asked for mercy, but Shylock did not want any of it. The young lawyer also tells Shylock that mercy is a quality of God. And if we show mercy to someone, it does good to both. But Shylock was still adamant. He did not want to forgive Antonio. The young lawyer said that the law allowed Shylock to take a pound of flesh, and he could do that. At the same time, the lawyer warned that while cutting off the flesh, Shylock should not shed even one drop of Antonio's blood. Also, he should cut exactly 1 pound of flesh. Nothing less, nothing more. That would not be allowed by the law. Shylock realized that he could not do what the young lawyer asked him to do, and he accepted his defeat. Antonio's life was saved. The young lawyer finally gives up. He tells Shylock that under law, he can take flesh of Antonio, but he is not allowed to drop a single shed of blood, and he cannot take more or less than 1 pound. It has to be exactly 1 pound of flesh. Now, Shylock realized what the young lawyer was saying was impossible to do. So, he accepted his defeat. Who was the young lawyer? Bassanio and Antonio found out later that It was none other than Portia herself, dressed as a young man. Later, it was learned that Antonio's ships were safe, and so he had not in fact lost his money. Thus, the story, which could have ended in a tragic manner, ended happily. Now, Antonio's life was saved. Antonio and Bassanio later found out that the young lawyer was none other than Portia. She had dressed herself as a young man. Later, it was revealed that Antonio's ship were not lost and his money was not lost. This story could have ended tragically, but lucky for all of us, this story ended happily. Children, I hope you enjoyed today's session, and I hope that you learned something new. I would like to end this session on that note. I will see you in our next session. Until then, take care and stay safe. Bye. Thank you.